An official welcome to this live stream. Today we're going to talk about how to get clients for your filmmaking business. The topics for today are, I'm going to start off with a short introduction about me. Then we're going to talk about where to find clients, so where clients actually are located. And then we're going to talk about how to approach them, because that's quite a process in itself. And then we close off with some final tips. If you do have any questions during this session, please drop them in the Facebook. I will have a look at it later, and then we can discuss it. So without further ado, I would say let's jump in. Well, then about me, my name is Yoshiya Mitsunaka. That sounds Japanese, but I'm actually from the Netherlands, the little country in Europe that nobody knows and nobody cares, apparently. And I've been a filmmaker for 14 years, and I've also been a business owner. Now, I started off 14 years ago by filming and editing myself, making a lot of event videos after movies. And then I moved forward to more corporate content, educational videos, commercials, stuff like that. And in regard to skill set, I did the whole nine yards. So I started off with filming, editing, then I went over to producing and directing, and that is something that I've been doing for the last years. So I'm passionate. I love IT, I love online marketing, and I love filmmaking. I think if you put those things together in the mix, you can make really strong, powerful things. One of those things are FilmKey. That is the platform I also own, and that enables filmmakers to work better organized. So it's kind of production management for filmmakers, which gives them structure to produce more content and also higher quality content. So that's something about me. About the images on the left top side, you can see me, I think, 14 years ago, shooting an interview with, I don't know which DJ that is, with a beautiful hostess, and all the way to the right corner where I am directing, I think, an educational video. So that's me in the corner. Now, maybe you can recognize yourself in this. When I walk through the city and I walk in a random place, I always see companies and restaurants and shops, and then I think, whoa, these people all need video, right? Because in my world, everybody uses video everywhere. Now, the harsh reality is that a lot of companies don't. But if I bike through the city, I always see opportunities for business, and I always think, oh, that guy can use that type of video, that guy can use that. If I'm in the gym, I think, yeah, you need a video as well. And if I'm in the bar, I think, well, you know, a good video will be nice here. So I see clients literally everywhere. But as it turns out, a lot of people don't use video. And today we're going to talk about, okay, which clients are clients and serious clients and which are just random companies. Because companies that sell goods online or companies that promote their business online are all potential clients. So here in the Netherlands, that is approximately 90% of all companies do something online, or they sell directly online, or they promote and communicate their services online. Now, if you think about where clients are, a lot of people, a lot of young starting filmmakers think about the real estate agents, the luxury resorts, or the after movies, or weddings. And so that is considered to be the low hanging fruit, right? We all know that they use video. So today I've selected a couple of markets that are not that much top of mind, but that are still very interesting. So for instance, marketing agencies, they use a lot of they advise companies to move online. Also, they give offline advice, but in general, they would advise people to do a campaign online. Now, every campaign nowadays is most effective using video. So those companies, marketing agencies, are really consuming and buying a lot of video content. Car companies, especially in Europe, that is a thing where cars are being sold more and more online. Now, every car could use a nice review or a nice short video that sells that car, right? So that's also a really growing and expanding market. Educational publishing. Education these days is done by video. Punt, right? So if you want to educate something, you need to create video. Now, there are tons and tons of educational institutes like universities, schools, trade schools, but also privately held coaching companies or learning companies. They all need to go from the paperwork to more modern video education. So that's a big, big, big market. And last of companies that sell goods directly online is web design companies, because they build websites for companies, and every website nowadays needs a video as well, right? So then companies that are not physically selling goods online but do promote their stuff online are, for instance, business services. Now, this is one of the maybe hidden secrets in the video production market, because these companies, which are legal companies, accounting companies, HR companies, consultancy firms, these companies use a lot of video. Now, I've run a couple of projects a couple of years ago for legal companies and consultancy companies, and they are not the most vibrant creative projects, but on the contrary, the budgets are really okay. So they have good budgets, they have a lot of work, and they are really professional in how they manage stuff. So that is really nice. Then we also have the leisure activities. Think about swimming, sailing, going on a boat, biking here in the Netherlands. All those activities are being promoted online. And what's best to do that with video. So also that market can be very effective for filmmakers. Industrial companies, it's the bit the same as business services, but with industrial companies, I mean the mid-sized industrial companies that make products for other companies. So really the business-to-business fabrication market. Now, I wouldn't advise you as a starting filmmaker to go to big companies like Shell or Unilever to do business with, but there are also a lot of industrial mid-sized companies that you can approach and that you can do business with. And it counts the same as for business services. They tend to have higher budgets and there's less competition, because everybody's moving towards real estate videos, weddings, events. So prices there will go down eventually. The last one is the spiritual and the coaching market. Now, especially during the pandemic, during this whole COVID thing, people were moving more and consuming more stuff in regard to coaching and spiritual healing. So churches, but also more the alternative coaching, like yoga and meditation, those markets are really growing as well, because they are moving more and more towards online communication. Now, these are just examples from my experience that I know that there are clients over there in those markets. There are tons of other markets where are also businesses. So my advice would be, don't go into the markets where everybody's moving in, but find your own market. So choose one industry or market that you like, something that you think is interesting. So maybe you have this passion for legal or consultancy, or maybe you like engineering, then move over to the more engineering companies, because at the end of the day, they all need video sooner or later. Now, how to find these companies, right? So you focused on one industry, on one market, and that is that also has another reason, because the more gigs you do within a certain industry, the stronger your product will be, because the more experience you gain and the more you get to know your client. And that is really beneficial for them, because they know you've got experience, they know you can make that type of video, so they will, you will be hired more often by them. Now, I use LinkedIn to find companies. Now, I know that LinkedIn maybe for you guys is something that only boomers use, but actually a lot of companies and a lot of business is being done on LinkedIn. So I would recommend to use LinkedIn for that, especially because they have this really fancy, easy way of finding companies really fast and really easy. So you can choose, for instance, in this example, I was browsing for manufacturers within Europe, mid-sized, so 11 to 50 employees. And then I found like 9,000 results, so 9,000 companies in Europe only. So you can really target your industry, your section that you like to approach. And then if you have selected a market, it's time for the next step. You select a market, you browse for companies on LinkedIn, and then you make a list with so-called prospects. So prospects are companies that you like to approach and that are interesting for you. Now you can just do this in Excel. So add the company, add the lead name, an email address, phone number, and add also a column when you have contacted them. This is really important because this is going to be your foundation of finding new clients. Then, if you have a company, you still need to know which person you need to have to get into contact or to close the deal, right? Now, 9 out of 10 times, that is the marketing manager, an online marketing manager, or the communicational manager. Anyone in regard to marketing or communication will do. So look that person up on LinkedIn by going to the company, then see the people that work there, or simply add it in the search bar, and then see if you can also Google or find their email address. So try to use a personal email address and not a generic email address like info@ or something generic. Then if you can't find the email address, use LinkedIn Messenger. They have this messenger system. You can invite people, or you can add them as a friend or a contact, and then you can also send them a message. Now, I would not recommend using Facebook Messenger for business. I know that we use Facebook and a lot of companies do, but if you're going more towards traditional markets like business services or bigger manufacturing companies, they tend to be more traditional. So see what type of company you're approaching. And if it's a casual modern company, you can use Facebook. If it's a more traditional company, then I would really recommend to use LinkedIn instead. Then when you've created your list with companies and contact persons, you've got this beautiful list of companies, and it's like your own Christmas list, right? And it will stay a Christmas list until you have converted them and contacted them. So make sure to do that, and that is going to be the next step. But before we do that next step, let me take a real quick look. Thank you, Leandro Librandi. I love your name, by the way. If you guys have any questions, just drop them in the chat. We're here to help. Let me check one more time on here. Anyone has questions? Okay, let's move on. Don't be shy, people. Just add questions if you have them. You can also do that later, by the way. Now, let's move on, because we have our Christmas list with prospects, and now we want to convert them into clients, right? Because that's what we are here. Now, you can, there are two main ways to approach clients. You can either give them a call or you can send an email. Now, a lot of people hate cold calling. Actually, the ones that are calling hate it, and the ones who are receiving the call hating it as well. So I prefer both, but most people prefer using email. So I will use this. I will use email for the main approach mechanism. If you have ever sent stuff like this, like emails like, I make great videos for companies. How about I make a cool one for you? You can use it on your website and on socials. Check my show reel here. If you've ever done something like this, it's okay, but don't do it anymore. Because try to put your mind into the head of the person who's receiving this email. And he will probably think, okay, nice, great, but what's in it for me? What's my benefit as a buyer of spending $500 or $1,000 or $5,000 for a video? What's my benefit for that? So without any adding a benefit, people don't buy stuff, right? I mean, if you don't know what a product is good for, then you won't buy it. And we all know as filmmakers that film, using film is effective and that it's good, but they don't know because if they knew, they would already be using it, right? So they don't know. And if you don't add it, they don't care about your email and about your product. So what you should do, what a very first start is with your Christmas list, is to research the clients that are on your list. And then what you're looking for are their need, because every company that's on your list must have some kind of communicational need. Now, I can explain a little bit about that. What we're looking for are, for instance, underperforming social posts. So let's say you're looking for this company on LinkedIn and you see that they're posting weekly content, but you also see that content is doing zero in terms of engagement. So no likes, no shares, just completely ignored. Now that is called underperforming social posts because they will probably spend a lot of time creating the content, but it's just not working. So that's a typical problem companies have, what you can solve with fancy video content, right? So their need is to have more engaging content. Now you can also look at wrong forms of communication, especially when you're a company and you're targeting like to a younger next generation. You need a lot of video because the younger generation doesn't read a lot anymore, right? So especially in the more educational realm, you will find wrong forms of communication. So for instance, if you stumble upon a website from your prospect and you see like this massive text wall and the page is for younger people, then that is a form of wrong communication. Also outdated communication. So every website you visit that's old and that's rusty and ugly and outdated, that's also a great opportunity because those people sooner or later need to update to stay in business. And that's also my fourth point, competition. For instance, if you have 5 consultancy companies, 4 of them use a lot of video in their socials and one of them doesn't, then that one is a perfect client for you because he will need to follow the competition to stay in business, right? So when you're doing your research about your clients, discover that. Watch the competition. Find out how is a company communicating. How are their social posts doing? How are their how is their YouTube channel, their Twitter, their website? Check out everything. Spend time in this because if you don't do this right, then you will never land a client because you don't understand what they actually need. So dive deep into this bit. And you can use LinkedIn to do your research, obviously Google, check out their website, their social platforms, and also watch the competition. Now, if you have done your research for your clients, and I would say do this not for your whole list, do this one by one, right? And then you do your research, you find a problem, so you find a communicational need, and then it's time to build a case by adding proof. Because if you have defined a problem and you say, okay, I've got a solution for that, who says me as a buyer that it's true, right? So you need to give strong arguments to buy your product. So build a case by adding proof. Now, I always imagine myself to need to go to court and I need to prove that videos are effective. So then I just get into YouTube or get into Google, do a lot of research, and actually there is tons and tons of research being done about the effectiveness of online video, because there are a lot of marketing companies who are looking into this and doing research. So if you start Googling and you start, for instance, are real estate videos effective? And then add the term research, because we don't want someone's opinion, we like research. You get tons of results, or research effectiveness of online video. Also, a lot of results, a lot of research is being done. And that research, or at least the results of that, can be used in your sales process. So if you found the problem of your client, find arguments, find research, and to use in your strategy. And very important, check your source when you're doing this, because there's a lot of content online which aren't really scientific researches, but it's just like someone's opinion. And we're not looking for opinions, because we all already have one. We're looking for solid proof. Research, official research. So counter check your sources, make sure the source is relevant and it's reliable. So then, but only then, when you have discovered the need and the problem of your prospect and you have solid proof, that's the right moment to reach out to your client. And only then, not before that. Well, then we send out, we've gathered our problem, our proof, then we set up an email. And that can be something like this. Hi John, really impressed with the article you shared on LinkedIn. Very inspirational. What do you think about the engagement of this article so far? We convert these types of articles to effective videos that are 35% more engaging on socials. I run a video production company in whatever city, so we're right around the corner. I love what you're doing and I like to help out to get your story out there. Are you up for a quick screen call to see how we work? Now, let's analyze this email and let's see what we've done here. So, the first sentence is your motive. You always need to have a motive. And that's the reason why you're approaching someone. Because if you're just doing this random, that will not work. So, really impressed with the article. So you also add a link you shared on LinkedIn. Very inspirational. Now, it's really great to give someone a compliment, right? We're all positive human beings. We all like compliments. So, motive plus link. Then you head over to the next sentence. What do you think about the engagement of this article so far? Now that's the pain point question or the problem you're addressing. So what you're basically doing is, okay, nice article, but What do you think of it yourself? Then you're addressing the pain point question, and then you move on. We convert these types of articles to effective videos that are 35% more engaging on social. That's your case. And you also add a link to the proof because that person does not know you. So maybe he thinks, oh, he's just making that up. So you add a link to your research. Then I run a video production company linked to your website in city. So we are right around the corner. And that describes who you are, plus the link to your company and the benefits. So why are you a good company for him? I love what you're doing and like to help out to get your story out there. Motive again, plus the problem. Are you up for a quick screen call to see how we work? And that's always add a next step in this email, because if you leave it open, they are not going to take the initiative, because you like to sell something to them. So you need to be in charge of the whole process. So add a next step. So do a quick screen call. So this is how an effective first email to your prospect will look. And then you wait. That's simply what you do. But to manage some expectations, if you put 10 prospects in your sales funnel, which is displayed here on the right, the first thing you do is raise awareness about the problem that they have, right? They have this problem, and they most likely you will lose about half of the prospects in this stage, because people tend to ignore problems that they have, because if we didn't do that, then we would never have problems, because the easiest way to get out of a problem is to just ignore it, right? So you will lose people there, but it's okay. Then you have the interest. So people are like, okay, you see a problem, you can fix it. And then during that stage, you will also lose people, because they either have no money or no time or something else that they cannot help you to fix their problem. Then during the decision making, that's also a bit where you will lose some people, because again, they will have no time, or they will go to someone else, or there are different motives that you will lose someone there. Then on the bottom of your sales funnel, you will finally have your new client. And trust me, this always works, but you just need to keep your funnel filled with stuff, with people. Put 10 prospects in, and by the end, you will have one, maybe two, maybe three, but let's at least you will have one. So then you've sent your mail, you wait for 1 week, and after 1 week, you still don't have a reply. And what you do then is you follow up, because people are busy, people have stacked mailboxes, and people just have a lot of stuff on their mind. So what you do, you forward your last email to him, and you say, you're probably busy on something big, so I'll just send you a reminder about how we like to help you expand your engagement on social. Are you available later this week for a 15-minute call? Now let's analyze this. First thing you do is show understanding for the fact that he didn't reply to you. Because we all know that, right? We are all busy. We all have a lot of stuff on our mind. So the first thing you do is acknowledge that. Then, second sentence, you also address the problem and the solution. So we like to help you expand your engagement on social, because now it's not doing well. Then add a time frame, like you see below, the 15 minute call, because maybe he thinks, well, this whole new video process, it's a lot and it will take a lot of time and da-da-da, da-da-da, because people don't know, if you buy a video for the first time, how much time it will take. They just think, oh, it's just another company with a complex new product, and I don't know, I don't feel about this. So be concrete, be specific, Just say, okay, 15-minute call. That's all of your time I need for now. And after that, you send it out and then you wait again. Now, most cases you will have an answer by now, but in some cases you don't. So we're going to have a look on the bad case scenario. So after 14 days, you still don't have a reply. What you do, you send a new email and you say, I sent you an email about 3 weeks ago about your company and how we can help you to perform better on LinkedIn. Research shows that 50% of LinkedIn visitors prefer watching a video than reading text. Are you open for a trial project to see if this also works for your audience? Let's analyze this. So, first thing, you change the title and you add a personal name, because maybe the former two titles weren't good for him. So they just looked, I don't know, weird or not interesting. So you change the title to "This might be interesting for you, John." Now, that's hard to resist because you always want to find out what's interesting for you, right? Then you start by refreshing the memory, because John receives hundreds of emails, so he probably doesn't know who you are. So fresh up the memory by saying, okay, about three weeks ago, this company, and I emailed you to help you to perform better on LinkedIn, which is also the problem plus solution, because he knows he's performing bad on LinkedIn and you have the solution. Then you add, research shows that 50% of the LinkedIn visitors prefer watching a video than reading text. Now, this is another claim than your other emails, because maybe that claim just didn't hit it for him. So maybe he thought, okay, 35%, nah, it's not that much. So try to use a different argument to buy the video. So new case plus link to prove. Then, are you open for a trial project to see if this also works for your audience? And what you do then is trigger curiosity, because if you drop a question that involves him into finding a solution for his problem, that will trigger his curiosity. So that is what you do in the reminder after 14 days if you didn't have any reply yet. Now, again, most cases you already are in contact with him, but let's say you have this really, really, really busy person and he's still not replying to you. Then we have reminder 3, and you'll send it after 30 days. So give him some time to recover, or give him some time to get back to you again. So what you do, you start your email, subject, are you still busy, John? I don't know, because apparently John is very busy, because otherwise he would have replied to me, right? So, hi John, I hope you're not buried in your full inbox, and I love to know if we can help you. We help companies like yours to be more effective on LinkedIn by creating stunning videos with our product. With our product, posts can get 35% more engaging than articles. Please let me know if this is something you're interested in. If this is not the right time for you, join our LinkedIn page to stay in the loop about this topic. So what you do, because this will be your last email, right? We're not going to stalk people forever. So you give it 3 attempts and then, fini. But what you do, you divert them to your social page, because maybe John is just very busy and he will be for another 6 months or maybe for another year. But then when he has time, budget, and sees an opportunity to create a video, you're on his list. You're in his social. He's seen your company name come by when he was browsing on LinkedIn, and now he knows how to find you. So we divert them to your social. We also add a new title and name in the subject in this email, and we add somewhat of humor, because you've already sent two other emails. We're kind of getting to know each other, right? So make it a bit more fun. but you still add the motive, like, I know you're not, I hope you're not buried in your full inbox and love to know if we can help you. That's your motive. And then you again add your case and your proof. Very important, never forget that, because otherwise you're just selling random stuff to them. So your sales routine would look something like this. You start by creating a list, do your research, very important, I think the most important stage of this whole routine. Then you build a case, evenly important, and then you start emailing. First week, email one, wait 14 days, email two, wait 30 days, email three. Now again, this is the bad case scenario. So this is when someone's really busy or he's just blunt and ignoring you. But anyway, you don't get a response. Most cases, of course, you get a reply. And then you go into a meeting. And if you've never had like these types of meeting, or if you're just starting, that can be a nervous moment, right? You need to sell your product for the first time. You need to feel confident. And one of the things that always helped me is to be dressed properly. So I don't mean underdressed. So don't go with your baseball cap backwards, your tank top and your flip-flops, because like you're the creative and you're just, that's just the way you are. No, that's not going to work. It's about a first impression. So dress well. Also, don't overdo it. So don't go out, rent a tuxedo and go overly dressed to your first appointment, but try to do it business casual. That is very depending of culture. So maybe in the US they will use something different than in Germany, for instance, but try to see what's done or what's the habit in this. And then if you look confident, you have a nice outfit, you'll also feel confident. And that is something that you express. Then what you do during that meeting, you introduce yourself, you define what's needed for the production. So what is the problem of the client and how can you solve it? So you talk about the solution. And again, you set out the next steps because it's your project, it's your production. You determine how we proceed. The client is the client and the client is king. So he just sits there and you do the production for him. So then second step, you make a proposal and you send it to him, you follow up. So you call about a week or you send an email. Hey, I sent you a proposal. Do you have any questions or can we move forward? Or because he will probably need to get approval from inside the company. Then you close the deal. Closing the deal means you get a written confirmation by email or by Messenger or WhatsApp, but somewhere you have a written confirmation confirming the proposal. And a proposal is built up by several legal documents, quotes, and stuff like that. Now, we're not going to dive into that part today. We're going to address that later, but not for now. Then, when the deal is done, you write a script, you schedule the production, you shoot, edit, and deliver. Now, this part, I've done this part really rapidly because we already talked a lot about approaching that client, but we will talk that this over during other live streams. So my final tips of today, schedule a weekly sales day. Sales is not something that you do every now and then. It should be a routine, especially when you start your first company. Your top priority should be finding clients, because you need, if you focus too much on filming and editing skills and lighting skills and making great cinematic stuff, but you don't have projects, then who's going to pay the rent? So focus on sales, especially during the first period of time. So schedule a weekly sales day, and I prefer using Monday. So sales Monday, because you've got a fresh start from the week and you can send out emails and you can start your week with positive selling energy. Then second, develop sales skills. Sales is just like filming And editing, it's a skill. And skills, you can learn. You already did a great job by learning how to film, how to edit, how to do that stuff. So develop sales skills. And that is also something that you do by doing it over and over and over again. Pardon me. So the more you do it, the better you will be. Third, persist. During the whole sales process, you will face a lot of rejection. Because if you approach 10 companies, seven of them will not be interested. They will have no time, no budget, or they will go to someone else. And that can give like this feeling of rejection, right? But persist, because it's nothing personal. It's just part of the process. And if you, over time, that feeling is something that will grow on you. And the fourth is actually something that happens a lot with starting companies. But sell when you're busy. Don't sell when projects are slow. So what I mean by that is it will take time to get clients. At least a month, and in many cases, like a month, maybe 2 or 3 months. So going from that very first email all the way to landing your gig will take on average maybe 6 weeks or even 2 months. So if you start your sales process up when business is down, then you're too late. So when you have projects, when you have clients, then that's the right moment to do sales. And it also has another reason, because when you have clients and you have a project, you feel confident, right? Because there's finally someone who likes to order your product, who likes to order your video. And then, I don't know, you express that feeling. So when you do that, that's the right time to go to new clients and to find them. So do sales when you're busy. So this is actually my, this is how I approached clients for several years. How if I'm looking for clients, I still work. I always use this sales routine. I always use those emails and it always works. So make sure you make your list, find a market that you're passionate about. Again, if you're a fan of cooking, go into the restaurants. If you love engineering, go into the engineering industry. Find something that you love, settle a list of companies, and now you also now know how to approach them. This whole stuff is being recorded, so you can watch it on YouTube. Go to YouTube, then type in Filmkey and you will get there. Like I mentioned before, we also have other live streams. We have another one on Tuesday. It's a Get Started in Filmkey live stream. We give like this 10-minute introduction about what Filmkey is. And then every week we have an extra topic. And for the coming Tuesday, that's make a shot list. So if you like to work better organized and more professional during your shooting, and you like to get like the maximum amount of content out of your shooting day, then it's important to create a shot list. And Tuesday we're going to talk about it, same time and same place. Well, thank you all for watching. If you guys have any questions, obviously you can also drop them in the chat after this recording, and I'll get back to you. So for now, I would say thank you very much for watching, and good luck with finding your new clients.